G'day guys, today what I'm going to be doing in this video is explaining what I think are the five pros and five cons of owning a Jeep Wrangler. A lot of people consider it to be the outdoor car, but it's definitely not for everyone. So here's five things on each side, just based on my personal experience. One of the big things we'll look at, as it's not actually an Australian car, the parts are very hard to get and you need to get a specific mechanic. So I'm going to be going over some things and many people say, you know, just empty every pocket, and it's kind of true, because every time you need a service or every time you need anything like that, it has to be a specific Jeep dealer or a Jeep mechanic or a Jeep specialist that has to look over this guy. So if you've got the money and you've got the time and you want to put your time, effort and dollars into being outdoors, great. If not, you just want a simple bang around car, might not be for you. Anyway, let's have a look at it. Yeah, so one of the first things that comes to mind is it doesn't have very good acceleration unless you're in four-wheel drive low. When I was off-road and going through the freshwater track at Rainbow Beach the other day, it had great pickup. You know, around the town, it chews a lot of fuel. And basically it's because it is a heavy car. It's got a small engine. This is actually a straight six petrol engine. I forget the specs on it because I'm not a big car fan. I've got nothing to do with mechanics. I don't know much about it, but I know for a fact that this being the straight six instead of the turbo diesel, which I kind of wish I should have and wish I had gotten now, you know, it chews a lot of fuel. Off-road, on the beach, great car, I love it. You know, outdoors, I love it. But around town, it's just a chewer. You know, we came a few kilometers up here to the range and back down yesterday, and it was a quarter of a tank, no word of a lie, a quarter of a tank. So it cost me about 80 bucks to fill it. So it was, what, 20 bucks up and back, and it was only a short little drive, you know, half an hour. So it's 15 liters to the 100 kilometers. Sometimes it goes up to 16 liters per 100 kilometers. So I'll try and do the conversion for you in American, but you know, this is mainly for people in Oz and Japan. Other than that, personally, I think it's got some good room in it. It's got a lot of good room for gear, but not a lot of room for people. So if you're looking for something a little bit more luxury, like your Land Cruisers or whatever, that can fit 8 to 12 people sometimes, you know, that's probably going to be your preferred option. But for me, I like this, as because of the shape, it can be easier to get around. So it doesn't have a lot of room. It's not as comfortable as your other sort of more expensive cars. But if you were looking to roll around the streets and look cool, you know, you'd go for a Hummer, which I considered in the beginning, but I actually really, really enjoy the outdoors. And that's why I prefer this. The other thing you've got to consider is that because it's an import, it's not an Australian car, it's kind of like when I was owning BMWs. I've owned quite a few BMWs both here and in the UK when I lived in the UK and had the TV show. And basically here in Australia, when you have a foreign car, except for Japanese cars, you have to get a specific mechanic or a specialist or someone who can deal with, you know, Jeeps. So they've got a couple of Jeep dealers along here on the Sunshine Coast, quite good, but they're always flat out, they're always busy and hard to book in. You know, I tried to book in just a maintenance job, 2 week wait, you know, so at both places actually. So one of the big things for me is that, you know, it costs at least $100 more just to get a basic standard service for the Jeep. Whenever you've got to get parts, it's more expensive, the work's more expensive. As I said before, just empty every pocket is a very common saying with Jeeps. So after you've done your, let's say, 150,000 kilometers, some people say 200,000, some people say 100,000, things start to go. And when they start to go, it can be hard to get a replacement. I've had some absolute horror stories come my way, but I've had some really great stories come my way. So next we're gonna look at the pros, things I actually like about it and things I can recommend and say are great about this car. So because of the nature of the Jeep and the shape and what it is, it allows me to go absolutely anywhere and everywhere. It's not as heavy as the Land Cruiser, for example, that we saw got bogged the other day when we were at Rainbow Beach. It was hilarious. It was trying to get another car out that was just fucked. And this one made it straight through, no worries whatsoever. It would have been better with a turbo diesel engine, which my next car is definitely going to be, but no worries, you know. Again, because of the shape of it, when I was going off-road through the rainforest track, it doesn't bump into anything. I can move across for other cars. For me, it's great. It's also relatively easy to park, easier than a lot of your other bigger SUVs. So for me, because I do drive it around on a day-to-day basis, I honestly think that it's good for me, okay? And because of what it is, I go down the beach a lot, I throw the dogs in the back, you know, I've got my two Roddies and my daughter, we go down, we'll go surfing, you know, they can jump in. It's got room for them, and it's good for outdoor use. Another cool thing you can do with Jeeps, people like to customize them. You see, people who own Jeeps, they like to spend money on it. It's a bit of a novelty, it's a bit of a hobby, you know. They change the lights, they change the front. I've got a bull bar and spotties on there and a winch, that's about all I've got. I've just got basics. You can take the top off. This isn't a soft top, although they call it a soft top, it's quite hard, right? You know, you can take the doors off, you can open up the back. You know, it's got some great features like that, but for me, I just like to keep it really simple and standard. As I said before, I'm not a big car enthusiast to begin with. I don't know a lot about cars. If it broke down, I'd be like, fuck, I gotta call someone. You know, I don't know really what to do other than change oil and give it a basic clean and really, really simple shit. But one thing I've done is I've taken out the floor carpet and the holes, because there's always sand and water and shit getting through my car because we spend so much time down the beach and outdoors. But that's just one of the simple things that I do and that I like to be able to do with this Jeep. Last couple of points. Personally, I think it's fun to drive. I love it. I love the car. And it does have a good resale value because they're in fashion now. People like them and they're cool. So if I want to resell it, which I am going to look at soon, I'm doing a few things up on it, and yeah, it keeps its value quite well compared to your Holden Commodores or anything like that in Australia, which, you know, lose half the value as soon as you drive them out the fucking dealership. So I hope you enjoyed this video, guys. Hope it helped you consider some things if you're looking at buying a Jeep or any sort of outdoor four-wheel drive, you know. Definitely have a look into things. I did a lot of research on it myself, but I honestly do wish I did a little bit more, especially when it came to the straight six compared to the turbo diesel and the V6 and other options that come with the engines. But I liked this car. I saw it and I went, yep, that's for me. It suits me. It was a good price. Came with a one-year warranty and I went, yep, cool. So I'm personally enjoying it. Thanks for watching. If you think this will help someone with their decision making or any information on four-wheel drives and or Jeeps, make sure you share it. And if you haven't already, subscribe. Cheers, guys.